ladies and gentlemen, John Bassett.
Where do I begin? Well, I begin in 1960 when I booked a lunch table in a rather grubby Italian restaurant on the Euston Road. It was for five university scholars, four of whom were going to become exceptionally well known, as you may know, and subsequently go to New York and indeed around the world. Two were from Oxford, two from Cambridge, but none of them had the same subject of study in common. Alan Bennett was already a junior history don at Exeter College with his thesis on Richard II's retinue, which has remained totally unpublished from then. Peter Cook had yet to qualify, we hadn't realised that until we started writing this, he had yet to qualify in French and German. But we both think that it's very doubtful if he ever did, because his success came to him so early. Jonathan Miller had qualified in medicine some years back. He was the oldest of the four and behaved most childishly. And was now a junior doctor at University College Hospital, which had sort of dictated the choice of restaurants so that he could dash out in his lunch hour and dash back. Dudley Moore was studying music at Magdalen on a music scholarship. He was the organ scholar, which meant that he had to either play the organ or conduct the orchestra or conduct the choir or whatever, as and when needed. And one of his duties was to conduct the treble choir up on the top of Magdalen Tower for the May morning greeting at 6 o'clock in the morning. And of course Dudley, being Dudley, was very often confused with the choir boys. Now, I was in my first job, which I got astonishingly, by going to the University Appointments Board late. It's important to go late to get the best jobs, because Barclays Bank and all the others will have gone through in February and taken all the bespectacled, dull, boring, dreary, money-pushing idiots. The fun jobs will be people who've said, oh, I must put it into the university, and then they don't for a month, and so on. So it so happened that I applied 3 days before the whole thing closed. And there were two jobs. One was for the Oxford Mail to be a trainee journalist, and the other was for this extraordinary long title, the Assistant Artistic Director of the Edinburgh International Festival, which is a bit like saying that Welsh railway station. And before you reel back in astonishment at the importance of it all, I should tell you that the salary was £11 a week, while my secretary was on 19. So the feminists concede that the struggle for equality had already taken firm root. My job at the festival involved such things as making phone calls to the Leningrad Symphony Orchestra, and you would start and dial it, and you know you were getting through, and then there would be a click on the line, which was MI5. And when you got through, there would be another click on the line, which was the KGB. And it's, although you're talking music, it's quite difficult to, when you know you're being eavesdropped by two people. However, one achieved it himself. I went over to Paris to see Jean Cocteau, because he'd been chosen to do the poster, and I went to collect his study for it, which I may say turned out to be absolutely identical to each and every other festival poster he had ever done for the last 10 years. During the festival itself, it involved in heading off any last-minute personal problems, mainly, that might arrive, such as the 82-year-old conductor Otto Klemperer falling madly in love with the quite ravishing red-haired cellist on the sixth desk of the cellos, and demanding that she should be promoted to the first desk, otherwise he would not take the concert. And persuading an 82, well, I'm 82 now, and persuading an 82-year-old man to give up his pursuit is quite difficult, especially when there's a concert in the main concert hall to deal with. Now, all this time I was playing with my jazz band, or whatever band it was, as it were, at dances. There were still a few dead balls and so on, and I found I could book those for the band better if I offered a cabaret as well, which in those days was either Alan or Dudley. But equally, and this is sort of weird, the main offices, artistic offices for the Edinburgh Festival were in St James's in London, Piccadilly sort of thing. And so when the musicians said, you know, where shall we meet to go to the gig, as it were, I said, oh, we'll come here, you know, sort of thing. So occasionally a 16-piece band would turn up at the doors of the Edinburgh Festival, or a smaller band, which is more usual, but also Dudley, who immediately started an affair with one of the secretaries, and Alan, who didn't, and Dick Johnson occasionally. Now, I never asked anybody about this, and of course now I think of it, it was a fairly rude thing to do, but nobody quibbled too much. And the big thing is that Robert Ponsonby, who was at that time the artistic director, took it all in good part, and then had the idea. He said to me he wondered if they were up to a performance at the festival itself. So in a sense, he was the first trigger of this going on. I suppose I offered them to him, you know, but I did by existence, but I hadn't come up to with an idea saying, now we ought to do it, but he saw them and responded. Now, Jonathan I knew because he'd married a Bedalian girl who was a couple of blocks or forms above me, but at Bedos, of course, they don't worry about not talking to the form above you like they do in some schools. Alan I knew from his cabaret performances, Dudley I knew, as we've said, from the music and his cabaret. And the only one none of us knew was Peter, though Jonathan had once heard him, just heard, because he was behind a newspaper saying, I see the Titanic has sunk again. But he hadn't seen Peter, you know, it was like that with him. So on that sketchy basis, I sent him and all the others, if it is right, yeah, to the lunch, and got a very servile return from Peter, who obviously, well, I mean, he was once in memory, he was never servile again. Now, it should be said that Peter already had an agent called Donald Langdon, because even by then, still at Cambridge, he had provided 6 sketches for Kenneth Williams and cast in the West End Review, Pieces of Eight. And as a result of that success, had written all the entire succeeding review of One Over the Eight. However, his agent Donald was firm in his advice that Peter, that he should have nothing to do with the festival review that I was proposing, as it would only harm his career. Now, there we were in this grubby restaurant. You'll understand that comedians of this standing are a bit hesitant to crack the first joke in front of the others in case it wasn't funny. So the initial lack of sort of rapport became menacing as, you know, everyone just stood around, you know, looking for somebody to make a move. And it was Dudley who made the move because his humour is much more down to earth and achievable, or whatever it is. And he goes in for physical comedy. So seeing the waitress going with dirty dishes going in through one door, and clean dishes with food on coming out of the other. And the doors are the ones that sort of go boom, 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 boom as you go through them. Dudley got behind a waitress with the dirty dishes going in, and immediately came out with another waitress with the full, you know, and he did the quick turnaround as if he sort of changed waitresses. It doesn't sound so good by description. But it was his. I suppose we were all so tied up, as it were, that actually it probably seemed funnier than it was. But, you know, Dudley could turn most things into humour, and that was one of them. And that started the other three, who rather like to think of their intellectual comedy, making their little jokes, you know, throughout lunch. So it was a good lunch, let us say. I don't think the food was, but... Anyway, now, he told... Oh, yes, I forgot to say, Dudley did this terrible Groucho walk behind the waitresses, which, you know, the low one. Now, everyone was happy with the idea for the show at the festival, and also happy with the £100 a week that Robert had offered them, except for Peter's ubiquitous agent. He wanted to show that an agent had some worth, and he demanded from Robert £110 from Peter, an extra 10. And this, you know, divided things. I mean, either they could have all had 110, but I don't think Robert would do that because it would look like giving in. So eventually it was agreed that Peter would have 110, on the understanding from Peter that if you think about it, and he gets 110, Donald Langdon's agent's commission would be £11, and therefore he, Peter, would end up with £99. Now the only condition actually that Robert did make in all this was the title, Beyond the Fringe. And people have tried to think if there's a secret message in all this, or, you know, it's a sort of a fairly abstruse title and so on. But in fact, it's extremely simple to decipher, and there's no hidden meaning. It's simply that at the time in 1960, the Fringe Festival, which was much smaller than the ordinary festival, was beginning to grow. And as you know now, it's about 10 times the size of the festival. But it was beginning to grow, and Robert really wanted to underline at that time that the show was something that was beyond the capabilities of the Fringe. So try and explain that to somebody, you know. Anyway, that's the whole page of dialogue gone by. Oh yes, and now, I'm sorry, but that's the reason. Now we have the fact that they'd all got together, they'd all agreed £100 each, except for Peter, who was 110. And so we wanted to sort of tie them in and so on. So we had a photo session that very day, of which there's one. That one is rather nice. Can you see between Jonathan and Peter's thing, you can see a ghostly figure. That's yours truly, looking into the glass rather than looking out. And I may say that was a chemist's shop. And he didn't seem at all astonished at four people coming in and doing that immediately, looking out and taking the photo and getting away. But anyway, we took a lot of photos, mostly in the festival offices. And then, to the total astonishment, really, of us all, or certainly Robert and me, is that after that meeting and agreeing to do it, and nothing on paper, and no, what should we say, no auditions of any of the sketches, nothing. It was just agreed verbally, and they all went away, and that was in February, I think, and they didn't get back together till August. They didn't write to each other, they didn't say, how about this, they didn't say, oh, I've got this fabulous sketch, nothing. And they didn't even swap telephones, I don't think. So there was this great nearly 6 months, I suppose, with them all doing whatever they do, and then they came back together to meet up for the festival. Now, it's normal for all the festival staff to rent a flat, and for us it's a week extra before the festival starts. And I had normally done that, but this time, of course, I had to rent a flat for about six people. Because there was Alan and Dudley in two rooms, and me, that's three rooms. And Peter and his girlfriend, about to be wife, Wendy. And it was agreed that, and Jonathan and his wife were very near, but, you know, 100 yards away, something. And it was agreed that Jonathan would come around at about 10 o'clock and work would start. So, it is true. Wendy usually used to go down and get baps. I don't know whether you've been to Edinburgh, but they have lovely things. It's only bread, but they're called baps. And she'd buy, you know, a dozen baps, bring them up, and then toast them. And we'd all have breakfast. And Jonathan would come around at 10, and of course we were still in the middle of breakfast, weren't we? And so we gave him a cup of coffee. And round about 11:30, we noticed that it was 11:30. And absolutely nothing had been done. So Jonathan suggested something or other. And we all said, no, that'll never do. And somebody else suggested, no, that'll never do. Everything was no, that'll never do. It won't work. It's impossible, you know. The fact that they had succeeded in Cambridge or Oxford, as you probably know, Oxford doesn't have the revue reputation that Cambridge does, because it doesn't have the equivalent of the Footlights. Now, I couldn't be there all the time, because I had to go and disentangle the conductor from his lady cellist and all that. But I do remember when an outsider, the outsider as it were, called Alan Brown, the well-known journalist then, I think husband of Catherine Michael, he arrived on Thursday and was totally astounded, because that's 4 days gone and only 4 days to go. Totally astounded that nothing had been decided at all at any point, that no sketches were written down as definite, you know, and they were still just falling about having laughter. However, they went on, and I'm pretty certain, because I think even I would have remembered it, that we never had a run-through, actually, of the sketches. Because they'd all, of course, brought their own. They all had two sketches that were theirs, identical, you know, with nobody in, just a single number. And nearly all the other ones were Peter Cook's as a basis. But although that's a basis, the big thing is, you know, everyone does a Shakespeare sketch. It's just that you have different thoughts on Shakespeare. And so Peter's basic Shakespeare sketch, we shoveled in the wonderful solo of Jonathan, which you will see, absolutely stupendous. And for civil defense and so on, that was mainly Peter. He got in the wonderful line, of course I can't remember the name of the runner, but the runner, Chris, I can't remember, the 4-minute mile. And, you know, Peter was playing a very proud, you know, don't be in the area, above all, get out of the area, the area is not the place to be when the bomb drops, you know. And people say, good gracious, you know, just get out of the area. And I, you know, to spirit them along, I have to tell you that we've, you know, some great people in our country can run a mile in 4 minutes. It had just been done then, which dates it. That's not, I can't do it as well as Peter, and you won't see that one. Right, now we move on. In those days, the performances had to be preceded by the national anthem, and then the curtain raised. And on top of that, the intended script had to be vetted by the Lord Chamberlain. Chamberlain Abbey was the idea. But one of them that was sent was one of Peter's, and all his scripts had been for the footlights, and therefore was scribbled over it, and there were notes, and there were things written all over it. And this one said at the top, "Enter three dreadful queens." And I don't need to tell you that this taxed the Lord Chamberlain mightily. He had already kept an eye on the musical Things Ain't What They Used To Be, which you may know, where there was a thing where a man walked along with a plank and he held the plank at what the Lord Chamberlain thought was a suggestive angle. Because it rather gave the impression that there was a male erection somewhere, you know, sort of a shadow. And the Lord Chamberlain seriously sent somebody once a week to buy a ticket and sit through the show to check that the plank was not at the wrong angle. And that, you know, it's unbelievable. The show ran for 2.5 years. Between Edinburgh and London, phone calls, letters, telegrams, all of them flew back and forth, but seemingly no amount of pleading or rewriting would shift the Lord Chamberlain's will. However, some of you may have heard the arguments about the benefits of a public school education, particularly Eton. So here's one that nobody criticised. It so happened that Robert Ransomy had been educated at Eton, as indeed, by fortuitous chance, had the Lord Chamberlain. And I think they were actually at the same level, if not the same house, but I'm not sure. At any rate, Robert, down the telephone from Edinburgh, made what he thought was an impassioned call on behalf of the sketch to the Lord Chamberlain, and in precise Eton speak, delivered himself thusly. "The moth we are pinning to the board is not homosexuality as such." And this was enough to soften the Lord Chamberlain's heart, and we were able to proceed. But with the provisos, the characters must be played as aesthetes and not as homosexuals. And all terms of feminine endearment, it had been Ducky and Sweetie and all that, all terms of feminine endearment must be excised. And a few years after this, so we got permission, a few years after this, the Lord Chamberlain's duties were curtailed and he doesn't look at it anymore. But just to bring you up to date, because dear Mark has found it, in the papers of the Lord Chamberlain, now available at the British Library, the resume of our show, by whoever had read it, is... Oh, is that? Anyway, a pseudo-intellectual review of tiny mental. I keep on thinking they were meaning menial jokes. Anyway, perhaps the Lord Chamberlain yielded to us because he thought the show wouldn't go far. How wrong he was. There can be no doubt that Beyond the Fringe was the public hit of that festival, particularly because it was created by the festival itself, and also because press and broadcasters, it's always difficult to give publicity to ballet, you know, because you just have something like that. Or the theatre, you know, whatever. You can show the star, but it's not much. But the show started and there was a build, and we had a press conference of which that's the local cartoonist. And it was a very, very good press conference, as you can imagine, with all four of them sitting side by side. And the increase in bookings as a result of that, and I think they were on Scottish telly and interviewed and all that jazz. But from not being not much more than half full on the Monday night when it started, and nearly all those were university people who knew about them, ticketed or attendance figures at the end of the week were 112%. So they've got to make up the shortfall on the first night and make 12% more than the total. I mean, they were standing in the stalls, three rows of standing in the Broadway circle, three rows of standing in the balcony. But the breakthrough of the show possibly is that it found astonishing humour, not only in the subjects that have been before, like Shakespeare, as I mentioned, or whatever, but also in trimming some of the subjects down to size. I think we were the first to do a sketch about an actual in-power Prime Minister, which you will see as a small selection. And the other thing was, even then, there was a sort of myth, like, do any of you remember a film called Diary for Timothy? It was a film made during the war, and it was all about a little boy being born, and by the time he's grown, you're going to have to decide that, Timothy, when you're grown up, you know, that sort of dialogue. And what do they say? The Germans want to be friends, but we are fighting the Germans. You're going to have to, you know, it was that sort of a film. And so therefore there was quite a mystique about, let's say that, not a reference, but a mystique about the Second World War. It is true that early on, and if you think 1960, we were 5 years away from the end of it, or whatever, it is true that I did see people coming out in tears, because it was the last number before the interval, for the war sketch. You know, you'll see one or two items from it, but there we are. And of course, Alan's astonishing quarter of an hour sketch, of which you'll see about 2 minutes, of the sermon, which you may have heard, I don't know. But the sermon is now used, certainly, in a lot of religious colleges, obviously, as to how not to do a sermon. By the end of the week in Edinburgh, we had no less than 14 managements.
Show some
things.
What?
We're
going to show some now.
Are you?
Yes.
Oh, we're going to show some now. I'm so sorry. Yes, we are. Off we go.
Good evening. I have recently been travelling round the world on your behalf and at your expense, visiting some of the chaps with whom I hope to be shaping your future. I went first to Germany for the Bundesfabrik, and there I spoke with the German Foreign Minister, Herr and and we exchanged many frank words in our respective languages. Precious little came of that in the way of understanding.
So you want to know about the war? The 30s were coming to an end. Heavy with menace, the 40s were just around the corner.
I'm stepping off my down to breathe an atmosphere that's beautiful.
At the Victoria Palace, Lupino Lane was entrancing London with Me and My Girl.
What a bit of love.
At Ascot, a year of royal victories, Walt Disney had done it again with Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs.
Underneath the gaiety, the storm clouds were gathering. Across Europe, German soldiers were dancing the hideous gavotte of war.
Then came a break in the clouds.
I have here, from Herr Hitler, a piece of paper.
I will always remember that weekend war broke out. I was at a house party at Cliveden with the Astors. We sat around listening to the moving broadcast by Mr. Churchill, or Mr. Chamberlain as he then was. And I quite clearly remember turning to my husband and saying, Squiffy, où sont les nerfs d'antan? I did not feel then that all was quite lost. Immediately afterwards, I got on the telephone to Berlin to try and have a word with Herr Hitler, who'd been so awfully kind to us on our last visit to Germany that summer. Unfortunately, the line was engaged. There was nothing I could do to avert the carnage of the next 6 years.
At this juncture, it'd be wise to point out to those of you who haven't noticed already, and God knows it's apparent enough, that Jonathan Miller and myself come from good families and have had the benefits of a public school education, whereas the other two members of the cast have worked their way up from working class origins. Yet Jonathan and I are working together with them in the show and treating them as equals. And I'd like to say it's proven to be a most worthwhile, enjoyable and stimulating experience for both of us. Wouldn't you agree, Jonathan?
Yeah, I'm most impressed by the whole thing. It's very good.
Well, suppose we are working class. I wonder how many of these people have realised that Jonathan Miller's a Jew.
Yes, well, he is a Jew, of course, but one of the better sort.
I'd rather be working class than be a Jew.
Oh, good Lord, yes, there's no comparison, is there? But just think of the awful situation if you were working class and a Jew.
There's always somebody worse off than yourself.
Well, in fact, I'm not really a Jew, just Jewish, not the whole hog. You know.
That was quite a stunner in those days. Maybe it's quite a stunner now, I don't know. Hope not. Right, we've got the 14 offers from the various managements. And they were all to be handled by Donald Langdon, who may be begin to understand of whom I disapprove. I don't know that he's still alive now, but anyway. So he decided that he would handle them because he was an agent and he knew what to do about agencies, though he didn't actually bother to come out to Edinburgh to see the show. However, our loyalties were to a super scurrilous chap who some of you may know, and those who don't, he's dead now, but might wish that they did know, called Willie Donaldson. He was the heir to the Donaldson shipping lines, which once upon a time were the same size as the big, what are they called now? The ones that we have now. And they ceased to exist now, Donaldson, because I think he went through the money. But he was a very sort of naughty, but pleasantly naughty fellow. And he wrote the Henry Root letters, have any of you heard of them? Where he wrote to people, including Mrs. Thatcher, such convincing letters that they weren't handled by a secretary or whatever. They were actually, I mean, the answer from Maggie Thatcher was in her writing and from her, you know, not somebody else. And then he printed, the Henry Root letters are his letters to them and the replies they got, and I can't tell you about it, hysterical. The result was, he wrote to a very famous model agency in Brook Street or somewhere like that.
Lucy Clay.
What?
I think it was Lucy Clay.
Oh, well anyway, it's where all the models went, where they were. And but he treated them as if they were an agency for ladies of loose virtue. And it was, he wrote as if from the military, saying, you know, we're having a bit of a shindig in the barracks on such and such a night. I'm wondering if you could provide a couple of likely ladies or something who would know a bit. And he got them, you know, you're completely wrong. You are not that sort of agency at all. We don't know that. And again, the two side by side are wonderful. Anyway, enough of Willie. He had offered to take the show and bring it to London before we even went up. That is partly, of course, because he was ex-Cambridge and he knew Peter and he knew Jonathan and he knew, therefore, the level of the show, which I suppose most theatre agencies wouldn't. No, until it was put under their nose. Anyway, he made the offer, and we had agreed that if he equaled the best offer of any of the others, he could have it anyway, you know what I mean, on that level. And I have to say, you see, Willie's niceness is that when he learnt that Mr. Langdon had cut me out of the entire procedure, I could have expected what they say, 2.5% of the gross. Well, because it was all contracted and gone and so on, he could only give me a little something. He gave me 1% of the gross, which in England worked out in those days as about £35 a week. But what I'm meaning is that everything had gone through under the bridge, so he just gave that on top, which was very nice of him. Anyway, the tour was arranged, because there's always a pre-London tour to get things into order, and it was decided quite rightly that the tour should start in Cambridge, which is almost the hometown, well, it was the hometown of two of them, and you can imagine you've got quite a good audience there. And it started, I think, at 7:45, but let's say 8, and it was still going at 12:30. Because they decided to try absolutely every single thing that they possibly could. And you know that Peter's lovely sketch about, you know the cliche about the eyes following around the room, you can always tell a good painting, because the eyes follow the room. Well, Peter's version was with all Ruben escalators, and it's the bottoms that follow you around. That sort of line. We had this staggering first night and gradually trimmed down the sketches a bit. And by the end of it, we then had one more week to go, which was to go to Brighton. Everything had gone stunningly well so far. But in Brighton, we got our one major bad review. And subsequently, we can't find it, but I subsequently found the man who'd written it in the middle of the other. And it was on the lines of, why make fun of Mr. McMillan? Either you approve of what he's doing, in which case you keep quiet, or you don't approve, in which case you keep quiet. why make fun of, because the guy in question, he was gay, he was a conservative, he was in the nuclear protection set up. He was in every single thing. He did amateur Shakespeare productions. He was in every single sketch, and he'd obviously taken it personally. Anyway, we got a really foul review from him, and by then, Willie had taken on board another West End management, which doesn't exist now. It was, you might remember the Albury Theatre. It was the Donald Albury. People called Donald. Anyway, he'd taken on the Donald Albury regime, as it were, who had, he'd been knighted for services to the theatre. And he was co-opted on the understanding that he would give us, because he was one of his, Wyndham's Theatre at Leicester Square, which seats 800, whereas the Fortune, which we already had under our elbow or whatever, only seats 400. And then, although the seats are double, the money is much more. I mean, a lot of people say that 800, the show wouldn't have gone so well, I don't know. Anyway, as Albury too hadn't seen the performance, he insisted on the four performers giving him a performance in the theatre with no audience, which they did with ill grace. They had noticed that, because it was just Albury and his secretary in an 800-seat theatre, and them doing the whole show without laughs. So they noticed that Albury had a very gammy leg and walked with a limp. So they all walked with a limp. And at the end of it, poor old Alan, who was just walking past, and he heard Albury saying, "The blonde one will have to go." Which is a good start. Anyway, the blonde one didn't go. And we opened in the West End, in the Fortune Theatre on the 10th of May, 1961. And, you know, it became the hottest show in years, or the new group sweeping away the old style revue, topical humour, all those headlines and so on. But my funny point was that for the first night, I had put Lena Horne, the singer, do people know her? Lena Horne and Duke Ellington's orchestrator, Billy Strayhorn, as my scene people. And of course they were in the Royal Box, and we haven't got anything here about it, but there was a whole thing about the Royal Box, which must have sort of muddled them a bit. But the reason we did it is, I mean, I've been in touch with her quite a lot since she sang on my 21st birthday. And she was singing that night at the Talk of the Town. Well, the lady in the spots was one of my secretaries, and you can see how far Dudley's got. They all gave me a book about, what was it, the philosophy of the bed?
Yes.
Yeah. But it's obviously too abstruse for me to cope with. And there was, sadly, which I've lost it, another picture of another table, because of course there were a lot more. But you know, the stage manager, you could see Jonathan right up at the far end. And Alan next to the lady next to me, looking away. So we had a wonderful first night party. And where are we now? Just a small section of the sort of things. So now you can see a few of them. And it's tiny little bits of each.
Some of us think life's a bit like this. It isn't, you know. Life. Well, it's rather like opening a tin of sardines. We're all of us looking for the key. Some of us think we've found the key, don't we? Oh, we think we've found the key. We roll back the lid of the sardine tin of life. We reveal the sardines, the riches of life therein. We get them out, we enjoy them. But you know, there's always a little bit in the corner that you can't get out. I wonder, is there a little bit in the corner of your life? I know there is in mine.
And so we bid you welcome to our court.
Fair cousin Albany.
And you are sweetest Essex. Take this my hand, and you, fair Essex, this. And with this bond we'll cry anon, and shout Jack Cock of London to the foe.
Jack Cock of London.
Approach your ears, and kindly bend your conscience to my peace. Our ruddy scouts to me this hefty news have brought. The naughty English, expecting now some pregnance in our plan, have with some haughty purpose bent Aeolus unto the service of their sail. So even now, while we to the white and blue strut, is brutish bowling broke, and fair upon some fickle circumstance.
Some fickle circumstance.
Get thee to Gloucester, Essex. Do thee to Wessex, Exeter. Fair Albany to Somerset must eke his route, and Scroop to you to Westmoreland, where shall bold York, and route it now for Lancaster, with forces of arms from Rutland, and join his standard. Fair Sussex.
Yeah.
Get thee to Warwickshire, and there with frowning purpose tell our plan to Bedford's tilted ear. That he shall press with most insensate speed, and join his warlike effort to bold Dorset's side. I, most royally, shall now to bed, to sleep off all the nonsense I've just said.
Perkins. Sorry to drag you away from the fun, old boy.
That's all right, sir.
War's not going very well, you know.
Oh, my God.
We're two down, the ball's in the enemy court.
Yeah.
War's a psychological thing, Perkins, rather like a game of football.
Yes, sir.
You know how in a game of football, 10 men often play better than 11?
Yes, sir.
Perkins, we're asking you to be that one man.
Sir.
Perkins?
Sir.
I want you to lay down your life.
Yes, sir.
We need a futile gesture at this stage. It'll raise the whole tone of the war. Get up in a crate, Perkins.
Sir.
Hop over to Bremen.
Yes, sir.
Take a shift, dear.
Sir.
Don't come back.
Right, you are.
Goodbye, Perkins. God, I wish I was going too.
Goodbye, sir. Or is it au revoir?
No, Perkins.
I mean, You know that wonderful line. He may not have stopped the show, but he certainly slowed it up a bit. Peter could lengthen anything. I mean, with Kennedy, of course, in America, he just added a whole lot more and so on. So Beyond the Fringe ran in the West End for a generous 4 years, but after September 62, it staggered along with a few changes of cast. But the four main players, of course, went to Broadway, and luckily I went with them. And it became a very hot ticket in New York City too, as you might imagine. And with impeccable timing, we opened at the Golden Theatre in the middle of the Cuban Missile Crisis. And it's quite difficult to be, you can always be funny in retrospect, but you can't be funny at the time. I'm sure Peter put something in about the Cuban Missile Crisis when it was well over. Anyway, I was staying with Dudley in an enormous flat that he'd rented. He was expecting another girlfriend. And it's extraordinary. It was the lady who, in, you know, they've made a musical of the Shakespeare, but she painted, there was the Blue Boy. There were well-known pictures all over. But she painted them herself in paint by numbers in this extremely posh flat. Anyway, Dudley and I were staying there, and on the Cuban crisis, Alan said, could he come over? Because, you know, if we're all going to go, we might as well go together. So for two or three nights, Alan was there as well until the danger seemed to be past. We got enormous publicity. We opened, as I say then, but once the danger had passed, everything took off. And within a week of opening, I mean, it's very nice. I don't think it's that unusual, but within a week of opening, they had been booked to appear on What's My Line, which was still running there.
Right now, panel, are those blindfolds all in place? In that event, will our first challenger enter and sign in, please?
Have you put that? No doubt, Frank, to throw me off.
Now, may I ask if you're familiar with our scorekeeping system? In that event, we'll let the audience in the theater and the audience at home know exactly what your line is. We can tell you that our guest is salaried and deals in a service. And let's begin the general questioning with Arlene Francis.
Well, there was so much sound coming in, as Buddy said. Is there more than one person present as a contestant?
Yep.
Have your names or pictures been in the paper recently?
Yep.
Would they be in the theatrical section of the papers?
Yep.
Are you appearing in New York?
Yep.
Are you appearing in a play in New York?
Yep.
Are you four?
Yep.
Are you the four funniest men that have ever crossed the water to America?
Yep.
You are the most dazzling performers I have ever seen, and I adore you if you are the four men from Beyond the Fringe.
Well, we didn't go very long with that one, did we? Now, if I may have the pleasure, next to me, Alan Bennett. And behind Alan, I believe, is Mr. Cook, right? Mr. Cook and Mr. Moore, Dudley Moore, and then I think we have Dr. Jonathan Miller. Right, Doctor? And these are indeed, I think, the four funniest people that we have had the joy of receiving in New York. I don't think I've ever seen such a collection of magnificent notices on an opening in New York in the last few years. I know you haven't, Arlene.
I think we've got the end out of kilter, but it makes sense, but it's the wrong events at the wrong time. But anyway, the satire movement had been started by Beyond the Fringe to a degree, and then everything became satirical or whatever it is, and so on. And as you know, Ned Sherry started, that was the week that was, and invited me to be one of the four assistants on it, which was great. And we tried to transfer, well, he did transfer it, you know. But of course, he had, in an audition, he had actually kept a space for Peter to link it before Peter went to America. And of course, being Peter, he didn't turn up. So there was a bit of a gap, and that was only audition. So Ned settled on David Frost. And there is always thought to be, it's not exactly animosity, but a bit of a put down between them, as it were. And in fact, Peter was an inspired performer, but totally uncontrollable, really. Whereas David did what he was told, did it very well, read his links, you know, and was a professional link man, which is what was needed. And so, you know, Peter may go on, well, he's gone on, but I mean, he may have gone on grumbling a bit and so on. But he did come up with because David used to lift his sketches and jokes, because David was performing also in the Blue Angel, sort of nightclub. And kept on lifting Peter's lines and jokes, and Peter said he didn't really mind the fact that they were being lifted, but what he couldn't bear was they were being done badly. And as you may know, he thought up this wonderful name for David, the bubonic plagiarist, which, that's very Peter. It's like we were walking along the street once, and he used to spray out ideas, you know, whatever. And he suddenly said, fornicazione is Italian for love. And then left it, you know. And I think for fornication is Italian, and I was right about it. But it was left to me to try, you know, quick seduzione would be one. And the last one would have to be masturbazione. But I can't get the third line, and I can't make it work. But undoubtedly, Peter could. They changed the sketches in America quite a lot. I mean, they did a lovely sketch where they were each explaining to a visitor that they should go to the Adirondacks or Cape Cod or there. And after they said, you know, Cape Cod, then one of the others would say, but that's not the real America. No, we'll go to the... No, that's not the... And eventually, at the end of the sketch, there was no real America, although they'd been to about 20 different places. But they also did international sketches, and one of those was the Great Train Robbery, which we had in Britain.
The Great Train Robbery of over £3 million continues to baffle the British police.
Good evening.
However, we have here with us in the studio this evening the Deputy Head of New Scotland Yard, Arthur Gepe.
Good evening.
And I'm going to ask him just a few questions about the train robbery.
Good evening.
Good evening, Sir Arthur.
Good evening.
I'm going to ask you just a few questions about the train robbery, if I may.
Good evening. Well, I'd like to make one thing quite clear at the outset. When you speak of a train robbery, this in fact involved no loss of train. It was merely the contents of the train which were pilfered. We haven't lost a train since 1943, I think it was, the year of the great snows. We mislaid a small one. They're very hard to lose, you see. Trains are great, bulky, great things, as opposed, for example, to small jewels. A tiny pearl, for example, might nestle in the navel of a lady and disappear for years, whereas a train with its huge size and the steam pouring out is altogether a different kettle of fish.
I think you've made that point rather well, Sir Arthur.
Thank you very much.
Who do you think may have perpetrated this awful crime?
We believe this to be the work of thieves. And I'll tell you why. The whole pattern is extremely reminiscent of past robberies where we have found thieves to be involved. The telltale loss of property, the snatching away of the money substances, it all points to thieves.
Thieves. So you feel that thieves are responsible?
Good heavens, no. I feel that thieves are totally irresponsible. Ghastly people who go around snatching your money.
I appreciate that.
You may appreciate that, but most people don't. If you like having your money snatched, good luck to you. It must be rather a queer fish in my view.
You misunderstand me,
I certainly do. Good evening.
Who do you think is behind the criminals?
We are, considerably. Many.
Well, there you go. Now, so what happened after all, after the ball was over, as it were? I don't need to tell you of Alan Bennett's achievements. It's impossible to be unaware of what he's done in the theatre, in film, in television, and in publishing. Peter and Dudley obviously got together for just about everything. Another West End show entitled Behind the Fringe, a tour of Australia, assorted films, and of course the TV series Not Only, but Also, which the BBC, having previously wiped the first eight of Alan's plays, also carried on wiping more than half of the two series. It also wiped the only full and correct version that it had made itself of Beyond the Fringe for the opening of BBC Two, and claims it did this under conservative duress since the Tories couldn't see any point in retaining old programmes that had already been transmitted. Needless to say, the possession and licensing of old programmes now owns the BBC more than any other activity. Jonathan went off around the world directing operas here, operas there, operas everywhere, in all the major houses and major cities, and also scoring big successes back at home in the Royal Opera House and the ENO. Most of these runs for the ENO have been brought back, well, about eight times each, redone every winter. Notwithstanding all that, he does actually claim that he wishes he'd stayed in the medical world, and had he not been tempted away by me from that straight and narrow career path, but we all know that he couldn't do without the publicity. You don't get that in the medical world unless you make a discovery or whatever. But anyway, in his Desert Island Discs interview, which I was abroad and didn't hear, but about 10 people rang up and said you must hear, so I heard the repeat. Jonathan referred to me as the same as Coleridge's man from Porlock, who I don't know whether you know, but I had to look it up. If you know about the man from Porlock, he was some little chap from down the hill in the seaside resort there. Who climbed up the hill, and it wasn't the right time, but I mean, he said, I'll count to radiometer or something, something tiny like that. And apparently the artistic flow of this, that and the other that was going on in Coleridge, as he did in Xanadu in Kubla Khan, was so interrupted by this man who had tapped on the door that he just couldn't go on. He couldn't start to go on for 6 months. And so I'm Jonathan's man from Porlock. That's me, isn't it? That's all I did for getting them together. We haven't got any more to show. So you've got to put up with me. Oh, only for 5 minutes. If there are any questions.
Thank you so much. A special round of applause for Mark for doing the film. Can I just quickly ask you, when you first saw the original script before all this started, did you have any idea for what a success it was going to be?
Well, basically I never saw a script, of course. But I knew in the company of those four, you know it can't fail. That's the big thing. You absolutely know it can't fail. And I've never seen any of them have to rescue a bad audience or rescue, because it's always a good audience. It's always going well. And, you know, like in the lunch, I mean, I can't remember any of the jokes or whatever, but in the lunch itself, it was hysteria.
I just want to say that we have worked together as well, and that this has been the most wonderful thing for us to see as your colleagues, as your career went on, John, at Thames Television. And watching this, and seeing your clips, and hearing your anecdotes, has been a great joy. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure that's not for everybody.
I think the show speaks for itself.